Joining me now is Mike Wendling. He is part of BBC Trending, and he wrote a book, Alt-Right from 4chan to the White House. Okay, Mike, welcome.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Yeah, appreciate it. So before we get to the book, which I'm fascinated by, what is BBC Trending?
So BBC Trending, we're a small team, started in 2014. We investigate social media. We have a podcast. We have all of our social media channels. We write things for the BBC website. But we're really trying to get under the skin of what's happening on there, trends on Facebook, Twitter, all the rest.
Yeah, there's 1,000 questions I want to ask you about that. But okay, let's start at the topic of your book. So for the folks who don't know, what is 4chan, and then how did it lead to the alt-right?
Yeah, so 4chan is what's called an image board. What happens is it's kind of an anarchic message board. It's very lightly moderated, and it became kind of the breeding ground and the gathering point and the rallying point for the alt-right. Now, it wasn't always the case that white nationalists came to 4chan, right? It's only in the past, say, 5 years or so. This is the place that sparked things like Anonymous, if you remember, the big sort of Anonymous movement. But that kind of hive mind that was developed by people who are just continually thinking up memes, thinking up actions, thinking up pranks, was manipulated and distorted. And there's one board in particular, a subsection of 4chan called Poll, which became kind of the headquarters for the alt-right.
So let's break that down further, because so 4chan was neutral in the beginning, as you point out. I mean, neutral in that it was a platform. Am I saying that right?
Yeah, I mean, it's a platform like any other, right? And you know, there was a political and also a trolling element to it, right? I mean, these guys were always pranksters. But you know, we definitely saw, particularly when you get into 2015, 2016, it taking a really right turn.
Right, so Anonymous also came out of 4chan, as you just said. So whatever happened to Anonymous? Because you know, we used to hear about them so much more than the alt-right.
Yeah.
Now the alt-right is dominant, and you almost never hear about Anonymous.
I mean, I feel like that the energy of Anonymous, number one, the alt-right people completely have took over 4chan until after there was a lot of attention on it, which we can maybe talk about in a bit. But that kind of made Anonymous kind of dissipate. There's elements of Anonymous out there, right? I mean, the whole sort of philosophy of Anonymous was, you know, sort of anarcho-libertarian, and some were more left and some were more right. But that movement sort of splintered. And then when the alt-right discovered 4chan, there was kind of no turning back.
Mm-hmm. So do you think that it's, in a sense, almost the invisible hand of the market, that since the Uber right, if you will, is not served by the corporate media, they needed an outlet or any legitimate website, et cetera.
Yeah.
Because it's, I mean, there are no legitimate websites going, maybe the Nazis, right? So it was it in a sense inevitable?
I think it's, I mean, and it's not sort of limited to 4chan, right? Because these guys are very effective across platforms. And some platforms have cracked down and some, you know, have not. But if you look at Twitter, you look at Reddit in particular, if you look at Facebook, they were all using and continue to use these platforms. What it kind of shows you is not that they have one sort of particular home. It shows you that these platforms can be used in all sorts of ways, right? They're agnostic, and particularly when you get to the bigger ones, they are commercial businesses. I mean, 4chan is a business, not on the same scale as those. But there's a chain of events that goes from the memes and the pranks starting, and the fake news starting on 4chan, going to through Reddit and things like subreddit the Donald, to Twitter, Facebook, and then getting into the mainstream media.
So many interesting things in there. How did the lulls turn into serious? Because it started as memes and pranks and they were kidding, right? But then all of a sudden they weren't kidding.
Right.
So what happened there?
Well, I mean, it was always there. And when going back to Anonymous, the political potential was always there, right? There was always this sense that you could get a bunch of people together. They could do a prank, or they could start a million mask march and descend on cities, right?
Mm-hmm.
So white nationalists, you know, the KKK members, the people who hang out on sort of extreme websites like the Daily Stormer, saw the potential there. right? And they moved in, and then they started to sort of take that potential and use it to their own ends.
Mm-hmm. And then how did they have success with it? And what does success mean?
I suppose success means that, you know, a lot of these kookier things just come out of the shadows, right? Mm-hmm. Richard Spencer, you know, perhaps the most famous white nationalist in the United States, you know, is not sort of speaking in like a hotel to a dozen people, but he's getting press all over the world. That is kind of what it looks like. Now, to get that, you don't only need an organizing platform or to be really good on Reddit or whatever, but you need a catalyst. And you need a catalyst to sort of spread your message beyond just that sort of corner of the internet, right? And that catalyst was essentially the candidacy and then presidency of Donald Trump.
Well, I mean, if you're talking about lulls and trolling on the internet and pranks and scams, that pretty much defines the career of Donald J. Trump. And so he was almost a man ahead of his time.
Right.
I mean, he was made for this movement. So, and that is fascinating. Then, and I know it's almost like a philosophical question, but would they have gotten another Donald Trump if Donald Trump didn't exist? Or was Donald Trump just got coincidentally just the right guy in this kind of atmosphere for it to take off?
I mean, it was a perfect storm, right? Because it's,
or a perfect stormer.
That too. Because not only do you have the candidacy of Donald Trump, you have an increasing focus on race relations. You have Black Lives Matter happening. You have Gamergate, this massive misogynist trolling campaign that has a sort of a political veneer of, oh, we just want things to be fair in video game journalism. All this stuff comes down the pipe at the same time, right? Now, I don't know if there would be another Donald Trump if, you know, Jeb Bush would have, you know, knocked him off in the primary, whatever. I suppose that's, you know, alternative history.
It does seem laughable in hindsight, but
right.
Yeah.
But, you know, certainly you're right in terms of, like, you know, here's a guy who has some people behind him who actually know what social media is doing, how to maximize his Twitter impact. He was, in the words of people on 4chan, they said, we took a meme and we made him president.
I think that there's a lot of truth to that. And so, look, Donald Trump, as I was alluding to earlier, trolled before we knew what trolling was, right? Oh, Rosie O'Donnell's a pig. And that gets press attention, right? And he does it over and over again. He constantly attacks people. And there was this resentment that had built up, both towards the establishment, which I think in a lot of ways is legitimate, right? But then they turned it into, no, it's not the people with power and the wealthy, etc. No, it's the Latinos, it's the Muslims, it's the Jews, and they're not gonna replace us, and it's the blacks, etc. Yeah. And he took all that resentment. And it was, and look, I guess I'm partly answering my own question. I don't know on a presidential level that they would have succeeded without a guy just like Trump, but certainly that movement was ready, right?
Yeah.
And would have succeeded in some fashion. Because look, you have intellectual lightweights like Jordan Peterson, who has comical points of view like forced monogamy. Really, we're having a debate over forced monogamy? But people go, oh yeah, that's right, forced monogamy. We should make women have sex with us because they won't right now. Like, just calm down, they will later. Just you know what I'm saying? But like, there was a pent up frustration that they seem to have taken advantage of.
Right, and you know, in times of political upheaval, there are always extremists lurking on the sidelines, ready to get in the game, right? And we see this not only in the United States, we see it in Europe, right? Right now, the Prime Minister of Great Britain is, you know, fighting for her life. There are extremists waiting for this to happen, to try and take advantage of that moment. This is what happened in 2016, right? And it hasn't ended, has it? I mean, I just got back from Portland, where I've been talking to people who have been rallying on the streets, right? I've been talking to Proud Boys, I've been talking to anti-fascists there. That's, you know, that is political violence on the streets of the United States, which is something that is at a level and a regularity that just we didn't see a few years ago.
Yeah, I really think that part of the central problem is the establishment bottling everything up and not allowing any other points of view. And so that has led to anger on all sides.
Yeah.
I don't know, do you share that point of view at all or no?
I mean, I think so. I think there's sort of, I get asked a lot, you know, well, should you even be talking to these people, right? Because mm-hmm. should you even be talking to the alt-right? And I can kind of see the point, I suppose. But, you know, with social media these days, it's impossible to prevent people from spreading their message. I see my job as a journalist in putting in the context, right? And trying to find out the real motivations and actually evaluating people and what their action, what their words lead to in terms of action, right? You can't necessarily just kind of close it down as the mainstream media, right?
Yeah, in the old days, they used to shut it down. You're not allowed on TV, we're done with it.
Exactly, right? That's not possible.
Yeah, it's not possible with the internet. So look, I want everybody to read the book because it's a really interesting story that I want people to be familiar with. Alt-right from 4chan to the White House, and you can get it at PlutoBooks.com, for example. Mike, before I let you go, I do want to ask you one last question. So these guys invented fake news in a sense, right? With the fake memes, etc.
Yeah.
And then Trump, in almost the coup de grace of trolling, turned around and said that his opponents were doing fake news.
Right.
Which was like the only smart thing maybe he's ever done in his life. But do the 4chan guys, the alt-right, do they know, no, of course we're the ones doing fake news. And the mainstream media, we're having fun blaming them for fake news when it's really us.
Yeah.
Or have they forgotten that?
Oh no, it's sort of a deliberate like cynicality about it. You know what I mean? When they put out some sort of prank that they think they're gonna trick feminists, mainstream journalists or whoever, they know what they're doing, right? But you know, since the election of Trump, actually, the attention on the movement has been really kind of like a pressure cooker. They have fractured, there's infighting. The sort of nucleus that used to be there is splintering. And while that sounds like a good thing, you can't predict what's going to happen in the future, right?
Right.
Things could go off in some very extreme directions, like we've seen. We've seen in Charlottesville, we've seen in Pittsburgh and so
on. Right. Yeah, I mean, we've seen the stochastic terrorism, the lone wolves, if you will. Right. And, you know, Al-Qaeda splintered, and one of the splinters was ISIS. So be careful what you wish for.
Exactly.
But we'll see. On the other hand, I mean, the idea that alt-right and neo-fascists would then fight against each other at some point is also inevitable. Like, oh no, my fascism is better than your fascism. Of course, they're gonna do that at some point.
It's happening, you know, they have these arguments over free speech about whether you should accept Nazis into the movement. And you know, the more sort of like infighting about that, I guess, the weaker this energy becomes.
Yeah.
But I don't think like we're nowhere near out of the woods when it comes to right-wing extremism.
All right, fascinating book. Mike Wendling, thank you for joining us. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
On the go? Don't worry, we got you covered. You can still listen to TYT at our new podcast network. Find us on Apple Podcasts, the Google Play Store, or at tyt.com/podcast.